S-P-Q-R.
Populus Quae Romanus.
The Senate and People of Rome.
Down through the ages, these words remind us that Rome, more than any other city in the world, embodies the essence of what we call Western civilization. Its birth is buried in myth. Its ancient past created a Senate, the Arch, and a man called Julius Caesar. Its empire was blessed by Augustus and the Pax Romana, as for 200 years peace reigned throughout the world. Its Christian past began with the conversion of the Emperor Constantine in 313 AD. Its barbarian past demolished the great city to be born again under the aegis of the Renaissance popes and their favorite artists. Today, the city on the Tiber throbs with the bustle of a great metropolis. Its citizens rush to work, dine at outdoor cafes, sip a quick espresso, cool themselves in the breeze of their fountains, cook their pasta, exchange their wedding vows, never forgetting in this place of palaces, churches, forums, columns, obelisks, and statues, that they are the Senate and people of Rome, the once and future eternal city. All roads lead to Rome, so the saying goes. This is the old Appian Way, opened in 312 BC. On this road, the Roman centurions marched out to conquer, marched home in victory. Here, St. Peter, fleeing from persecution, met Christ and asked,
Quo vadis? Lord, whither goest thou?
But to find Rome's beginnings, one must go back farther, to the 8th century BC, and the myth of Romulus and Remus. Legend has it, they were suckled by a she-wolf and grew to establish a village here. The legend further relates that Romulus invited the unsuspecting Sabines to a festival, whereupon the Roman men fell upon the women and the famous Rape of the Sabines began. Thus, so the story goes, the village of Rome was first peopled. Here on the Palatine Hill, the early Romans lived until desire for extra territory and the rise of exceptional men like Julius Caesar drove them out of their village to conquer an empire. Caesar was a soldier, statesman, orator, and writer who set out to conquer Gaul, driving as far north as Britain. The first Gauls inspired such terror that their defeat was associated with the supernatural. This is the famous sculpture of the dying Gaul, a fine example of Hellenic pathos. The mortally wounded warrior has agonizingly dragged himself out of the thick of battle to struggle alone against death. The strong musculature of his powerful body, so different from that of the supple Greek athletes, marks him as a barbarian, as does his greasy hair and mustache.
The Romans greatly admired Greek sculpture, having little originality of their own. Here, for example, is the god Hermes in the Vatican Museum, a Roman copy from Praxiteles. And here, the famous Discobolus, copied from Myron.
Artistically, ancient Rome excelled in making portrait masks. Here, in these masks, was a real, original idea. Not the idealized Greek formula, but a true-to-life picture in bronze or marble of what a man or woman really looked like. Double chin, wrinkled neck, warts and all. Much of early Roman religion was a family affair. To the ancient Romans, honoring paterfamilias was an important part of their lives. Such veneration was part of their political life as well. The emperor was considered the father of his country, an idea that people in America have inherited, to which the statuary in Washington, D.C. will attest. Thus, when Julius Caesar's nephew Octavian became the first Roman emperor, Augustus, he was looked upon as pater patriae, father of his country. After the Augustan age came the tyrants, like Caligula and Nero, followed then by the reign of the good emperors, like Hadrian and Marcus Aurelius, which marked the high point of the empire, and indeed one of the high points of all civilization. For now the Romans showed that for which we remember them best. They were the greatest builders in the history of mankind. No people before or since have surpassed them. And if one architectural device of their making exceeded any other, it was the idea of the arch and the keystone which made it work. Once devised, the Romans built triumphal arches everywhere in Rome. These arches were lavishly covered with stories of triumph, heroes' names, prisoners in chains. The emperor Septimus Severus dedicated this arch to his two sons, Caracalla and Geta. But Caracalla, one of the future tyrants of Rome, killed his brother Geta and ruled Rome alone. Caracalla, tyrant though he was father of his country enough to know that his people needed, as Shakespeare said,
circuses as well as bread.
So he built these sumptuous baths. Imperial baths like these had hot, cold, and tepid swimming pools. In the 4th century AD, there were some 900 baths in Rome. The largest and most beautiful were the baths of Diocletian, built by Christians condemned to hard labor. Traces of these baths are still to be seen under the Church of St. Mary of the Angels. Unbelievably, in the time of the Emperor Trajan, there were over 1 million people living in Rome, and a daily bath was woven into the very fabric of their lives. When you consider that Queen Elizabeth I of England only bathed once a year, and the custom of the once-a-week bath on Saturday night persisted to the present day, you come to realize that the ancient Romans, living in their apartment houses, listening to their orators, bathing every day, were surely the cleanest, perhaps the most civilized people the world has ever seen. Another original Roman idea was the forum, gathering places for the people, an ancient precursor to our shopping malls. Here, the Senate met. Here were temples to the gods and to the Vestal Virgins. Here were marketplaces, theatres, halls of justice. Along the Sacra Via in the Roman Forum is this temple dedicated to the Emperor Antoninus Pius, who reigned 23 years in peace and moderation. Here it stands from the year 141 AD. remarkably preserved, testimony to Rome's extraordinary building skill. But the Pax Romana came in time to be under attack from without by barbarians, and from within by a new order called Christianity. As the empire fell apart and the world into disarray, Christianity preached brotherly love and the hope of life after death. On October 23rd, 312 AD, the Emperor Constantine was approaching Rome to do battle with his rival, Maxentius. Legend has it that he saw a flaming cross in the sky and said to his troops,
"In this sign shalt thou conquer."
At that moment, he became a Christian and marched triumphantly into Rome. But while Christianity flourished and spread, Rome was sacked again and again. It fell into ruins. The city of 1 million became a ransacked village of 20,000. The Middle Ages had begun.
Organization within the Catholic Church was based on communities, with a bishop at the head of each. The idea arose that the first bishop of each community had been appointed by one of the apostles. Saint Peter, Bishop of Rome, was considered to be the first pope. In the year 379 AD, the Emperor Theodosius turned the title of Most High Priest, Pontifex Maximus, over to the Pope, where it has resided ever since. Christianity became the state religion, and the power of the Pope grew enormously.
Early in the 15th century, at the moment the candle of civilization seemed ready to flicker and die, a rebirth of learning reasserted itself 300 miles north of Rome, in the city of Florence. The Renaissance, the renewal of life, vigor, rebirth, and revival had begun. But revival of what? Revival of what lay in the ruins of Rome. Florence, though it gave birth to the Renaissance, had nothing in its history to revive. Its artists, among them Brunelleschi, whose Duomo is considered to be the monument that most completely bridges the gap between the Middle Ages and the Renaissance, traveled to Rome for inspiration. And there, he saw a building that set his imagination afire. A circular building, the best preserved monument of Imperial Rome, the Pantheon. Erected in 27 BC by Augustus General Agrippa, whose name is incised above the porch, it wasn't the name that attracted Brunelleschi, it was the dome. No such space, huge in every dimension, had been domed since ancient Rome. 16 granite columns support the porch. At the center of the coffered ceiling is an enormous round opening through which the interior is lit, while the early Renaissance world stood by in skepticism. Brunelleschi learned his lesson and translated this into this. While Brunelleschi was studying the Pantheon, another Florentine, Michelangelo Buonarroti, was invited to Rome by Cardinal San Giorgio, where he also studied the remnants of the ancient city. Statues, like the Belvedere Torso, the Apollo Belvedere, and the Laocoon group. Inspired by all he saw, the 25-year-old Michelangelo sculpted the Pietà, which now stands just inside the portals of St. Peter's. It was immediately hailed as a work of genius, and fellow artists, jealous of this Florentine upstart, circulated the rumor that the work was not his. In a fury, he slashed his signature into the Virgin's sash, the only piece he ever signed. If Rome was to have a profound effect on Michelangelo, Michelangelo was to have an even greater effect on Rome. He was invited by Pope Julius II to carve a tomb for him that would be placed inside the new St. Peter's. Together, the two of them, Michelangelo and Pope Julius, represent a metaphor for the Roman Renaissance. That is, a brilliant, demanding, energetic Pope in tandem with an equally brilliant, energetic artist. Indeed, it was a toss-up who the greater figure was, Pope or artist. If artists owed their commissions to art-loving popes, likewise, the popes owed their immortality to these Renaissance geniuses. While Michelangelo was busy designing Julius's tomb, which was to be a huge affair containing no less than 40 figures, Julius had a change of heart about his priorities and told the sculptor that he wanted the work stopped. Michelangelo was now ordered to paint the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel. Michelangelo refused, said that Terribilità,
I'm a sculptor, not a painter.
But Julius was adamant, and Michelangelo, promised a free hand, gave in. As for the tomb, it never was completed. Only one figure came to fruition, but what a figure. By the time Michelangelo began work on it, Julius II was dead, and the then Pope, Paul III, was tired of seeing his artist working on the tomb of his predecessor. He wanted him to start the Last Judgment for the Sistine Chapel, and went to the artist's studio to tell him so. There, he found a huge seated figure of Moses. When Michelangelo learned what the Pope wanted, so the story goes, he reached out in anger and struck the figure on the knee. Another story relates that when Michelangelo had completed his figure, he was so taken with his own handiwork that he tapped it on the knee and said,
Arise, Moses, and speak.
Whatever story you care to believe, they're probably both apocryphal. The dent is clearly evident. Merely a detail on a figure of authority that gazes at the viewer in stern majesty. Michelangelo's hand is to be found everywhere throughout Rome. One of the artist's most splendid achievements is the Piazza del Campidoglio. On the occasion of Charles V's visit in 1536, Pope Paul III decided that Rome, which had been sacked by that very Holy Roman Emperor just 9 years before, should be restored to its former elegance. He called upon Michelangelo to take on the task. The square is lined by three buildings: the Senatorial Palace, the Conservator's Palace, and the New Palace. The most striking feature of the whole complex is the ornate patterned floor of the piazza. Until recent times, the center was graced by an ancient equestrian statue of the Emperor Marcus Aurelius, standing, as it were, on a geometric carpet. Cast in bronze and originally covered with gold, the statue is a fine example of Roman realism of the second century. It now resides inside the Capitoline Museum to protect it from the elements. In 1547, Paul III appointed Michelangelo, now 72 years old, to be chief architect of the Vatican. Bramante had been the original architect of the new St. Peter's. After he died in 1514, a number of architects came and went, each revising the plans until Michelangelo took over. He vowed to return to the original overall Bramante plan. As was customary with Michelangelo, his uncompromising intransigence caused everyone around him to complain. The artist scholar, never a committee man, paid not the slightest attention. He worked on St. Peter's, surrounded by plots, intrigues, and gossip. By the time of his death in 1564, at the age of 89, his stamp had been indelibly placed on the Eternal City. Nowhere, more strikingly, than on the glorious dome of St. Peter's.
As Michelangelo had Julius II and Paul III, so it was left to the papacy of Urban VIII, in partnership with Gian Lorenzo Bernini, to bring the final flowering of splendor to Rome during the Counter-Reformation. Luther and the Protestant Reformation had shaken the Catholic Church to its very roots. But once more the phoenix rose, this time with a fervor of spiritual excitement never equaled before or since, translated into a style called the Baroque. Nowhere is this new flowering more graphically presented than in the statue of Saint Teresa of Avila in the Cornaro Chapel in Santa Maria della Vittoria, sculpted by Bernini in 1652. Saint Teresa is shown in ecstasy. Never was sacred love expressed so romantically, even erotically. Saint Teresa describes the moment God sent his angel to pierce her heart with his arrow.
The pain was so sharp that I cried aloud. But at the same time, I experienced such delight that I wished it would last forever.
Sitting in theater boxes at either side of the spectacle, 8 members of the Coronado family look on in wonder. Is this architecture, sculpture, painting, or stage design? The answer is yes, all of the above. A transcendent moment, fixed in time.
One of the most glorious expressions of Bernini's genius is to be seen in the Piazza Navona, one of the loveliest spots in Rome. The piazza, built on the site of an ancient stadium, one more example of Rome as the Eternal City, seems permanently on holiday. It is lined with small, family-owned trattorias, the most famous, Tre Scalini, where passers-by come to savor the tartufo, a rich chocolate ice cream. The crowning glory of the piazza is the Fountain of the Four Rivers. 4 figures represent the 4 quarters of the world. The Danube for Europe, the Nile for Africa, the head veiled, because of course in 1651, when the fountain was completed, the source of the Nile was unknown. The Ganges for Asia, and the Platte for America. Look at the statues of the Danube and the Platte. Their arms are raised in a defensive gesture against the supposed collapse of the facade of St. Agnes in Agony, the church designed by Francesco Borromini, Bernini's arch rival in Counter-Reformation Rome. Rome is filled with Bernini fountains. One of the most charming is the Triton, as happy an example of Roman Baroque as one can find. 4 dolphins support an open scallop, in which sits a triton, blowing into a conch shell. The bees are the coat of arms of the Barberini family, of which Pope Urban VIII was a member. Said the Pope to Bernini,
"It is your good luck, Cavaliere, to see Matteo Barberini Pope. But we are even luckier that the Cavaliere Bernini lives at the time of our pontificate."
So close was their relationship that it is said that the Pope held a mirror up for the sculptor so that he could carve his own likeness into the face of this superb David. In 1623, Pope Urban VIII decided to build a grand palace on the Quirinale Hill. Today, the elegant building, whose fabric is under major reconstruction, houses a museum of treasures. Perhaps the greatest is a small but evocative painting called La Fornarina, painted by Raphael. La Fornarina was, as her name suggests, a baker's daughter. She was also Raphael's mistress. But for unadulterated Roman Baroque exuberance, one must look upwards to the ceiling of Sant'Ignazio, the church dedicated to the founder of the Jesuit society, Saint Ignatius of Loyola. A dynamic visionary who carried the word of Roman Catholicism to the four corners of the earth. This ceiling, painted by Andrea Pozzo, a remarkable example of all the tricks of the Baroque style, tells the story of Saint Ignatius' work. In a series of unparalleled foreshortening, the figures seem to tumble out of the sky. Allegorical representations of Europe, Asia, Africa, and America, displaying in wild abandon where the missionaries of the Society of Jesus had spread the word of God. Somewhat further back in the nave, one looks up to see the interior of a dome. But it's not a real dome, it's a trick. Another case of trompe-l'œil, literally to deceive the eye. For this dome, with all its features, is pure paint. And the artist, anxious that you should get the full effect of his optical illusion, has placed a spot in the middle of the floor, so that when you look up, you see a real dome. Stand at any other place, and you will see at once that it's a fake. But what a wonderful fake! The quintessence of the Baroque in miniature is the wonderful San Carlo alle Quattro Fontane by that troubled but brilliant architect Francesco Borromini. Borromini may very well have been the most gifted and inventive architect of the Counter-Reformation. This tiny church is a whirlwind of movement. Not a straight line anywhere. Bizarre yet elegant turmoil that reveals the character of the man who created it. A man who was filled with his own turmoil and at length committed suicide in 1667. One other artist stands out from all others during the Counter-Reformation. A strange, violent man, a loner, a passionate criminal who murdered a man and had to flee Rome. His name was Caravaggio, and he painted religious subjects with the faces of the people he saw in the streets. Here, for example, are two stunning Caravaggios to be found in the small Cerasi Chapel of Santa Maria del Popolo. We see Paul, formerly Saul of Tarsus, a persecutor of Christians, as a young man. Stricken, prostrate, his eyes blinded.
Suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven, and he fell to earth, and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me do?
Caravaggio, master of light and dark, has captured Paul's conversion in a visitation of light. One can find no source for the light. No window, no door. It is just there, the presence of God. Now observe the face of Peter on the other side of the tiny chapel. The rock on which the Catholic Church is founded is shown as a frightened, feeble old man, muscles flaccid, beard white, mouth toothless. Here, humanity abounds, even in the faces of the conspirators who strain to upright the cross from which they will crucify Peter upside down. Here, in San Luigi dei Francesi, is Caravaggio's The Calling of St. Matthew. In a dark room, five men, seated at a table, are distracted from counting money by the entrance of Christ accompanied by St. Peter.
He saw a man named Matthew sitting at the receipt of custom.
Christ's pointing finger singles out Matthew, seated beside an old man in spectacles. A shaft of light strikes the wall and illuminates the faces around the table. A boy with a feather in his hat, a familiar figure in Caravaggio's paintings, looks scornfully on. When Caravaggio first painted this picture, the clergy of San Luigi were outraged and vowed that the dramatic, realistic approach that was Caravaggio's trademark was scandalously disrespectful. Time has proven them wrong, and Caravaggio's masterworks, the great art we recognize them to be. The devout expression of a violent, turbulent man, who here painted himself in as the decapitated head of Goliath. One of the most salubrious events of the Counter-Reformation is appropriately called Aqua Paula, or Paul's Water. In the year 1612, Paul V ordered that the ancient Roman aqueducts, which 1500 years earlier had provided each Roman with his daily bath, should be rebuilt. Clear, sweet, fresh water from mountain streams now rushed into the city streets. Never was a papal blessing more practical than the burgeoning of the fountains that were then constructed and have continued to delight and refresh the Romans to this present day. Not just a trickle, not just a flow, but a flood of water spewing out of fountains that adorn the city.
In the late 17th and early 18th centuries, the last great spectacles to appear on the Roman stage were constructed. The Spanish Steps, the Trevi Fountain, and the new facade on the ancient Basilica of St. John Lateran.
There are 300 churches in Rome, but only four bear the title Major. St. John Lateran is one. The first to be dedicated to the Holy Redeemer. It symbolizes the triumph of Christianity over paganism, and thus deserves its title, Mother and Head of all the churches in the city and the world. It is the Cathedral of Rome, and though its facade is relatively new, the Basilica dates from 314 AD. The Basilica of St. Mary Major is another of the foremost four. It dates from 432 AD and is a remarkable example of early Christian architecture with its perfect proportions and two rows of Ionic columns. But it is the mosaics in the nave, the arch and the apse, brilliant with color, depicting scenes from the Old Testament, which are its most spectacular feature. Its coffered ceiling, decorated with real gold from Peru, was a gift from Ferdinand and Isabella of Spain to the Spanish Pope, Alexander VI, in 1492. The third basilica in this group of majors is St. Paul outside the gates, far from the madding crowds of downtown Rome, in a serene tropical garden, stands this sun-washed basilica. The interior is a veritable forest of granite monoliths, 80 columns in all. high up on the walls, above the clerestory, encircling the interior, barely visible through the screen of alabaster on the windows, is a mosaic portrait of every pope from St. Peter to John Paul II, all 264 of them. And of course, the last basilica entitled to be called Major is St. Peter's in the Vatican. The entire history of Christianity and more, the joint efforts of popes, artists and architects are reflected in this basilica, which is the largest of all Christian sanctuaries. Even today, when skyscrapers in other metropolises pierce the sky, no building in Rome outtops Michelangelo's 450-foot dome of St. Peter's, crowning glory of Christendom. The 19th century saw the unification of Italy and the reduction of influence of the Vatican into the smallest principality in the world, a state unto itself. With the decline of the political power of the Pope came also the decline of the quality and elegance of art and architecture in the Eternal City. Witness, for example, the huge white monument inaugurated in 1911 in honor of King Victor Emmanuel II. The dazzling white marble structure is thought by many to look like an enormous wedding cake. Its overblown style at odds with the symmetry and elegance of ancient, Renaissance, and Counter-Reformation Rome.
If the quality of art and architecture declined in the 19th century, this regrettable state of affairs was counterbalanced by a proliferation of artists and writers from everywhere who flocked to Rome.
The Villa Medici, originally built in 1570, became, in 1803, the seat of the French Academy. Charles Dickens visited Rome in 1846 and wrote a travel book there. Rome provided inspiration in 1817 to George Lord Byron, who wrote, "O Rome, my country, city of my soul." Shelley composed Prometheus Unbound while lodging in the Corso. The poet John Keats took up residence in Rome adjacent to the Spanish Steps, where he died in 1821. Today, the building houses a museum and library devoted to English poets of the 19th century. All these artists and men of letters congregated at the famous Café Greco, a coffee house in the Via Condotti, which opened its doors in 1760. Gibbons, Goethe, Hans Christian Andersen, Franz Liszt, even Buffalo Bill dropped into the Café Greco when he brought his roadshow to Rome. The tradition of Rome as inspiration to creative visitors from foreign soil continues to the present day. Perhaps the most dramatic example is Tennessee Williams, the Roman Spring of Mrs. Stone. Who can forget the scene in which the love-starved Mrs. Stone, played so movingly by Vivien Leigh, drops the key to her front door from her balcony to a poor young Roman waiting below in the Spanish Steps, eager for her favors and her money. The tradition of tossing a coin into the Trevi Fountain to ensure a return visit to Rome is of unknown origin, but it was described as long ago as 1860, when Nathaniel Hawthorne wrote of the custom in his book, The Marble Faun. Rome wasn't built in a day. It grew and continues to grow, its development etched in stones. And of all the stones in Rome, none is more characteristic than its most famous landmark, the Colosseum. Here was the scene of grisly spectacles, fights to the death between gladiators, lions, Christians, staged for the amusement of all classes, including slaves, of which Rome had upwards of 40,000. Here also is an example of a distinguished piece of engineering, a Roman invention, the amphitheatre, still standing since the Emperor Vespasian in 72 AD commanded that it should be built. To this day, the Colosseum, in all its imperturbability, continues to awe the first-time visitor. It is here that one remembers the words of George Lord Byron.
While stands the Colosseum, Rome shall stand. When falls the Colosseum, Rome shall fall. And when Rome falls, the world.
Today, Rome is a fascinating mélange of the sacred and profane. On the one hand is the hellish noise of the Vespers and Lambrettas that roar through the narrow streets, causing pedestrians to jump for their lives. On the other hand is the heavenly Trinità dei Monti, pink and serene in the golden afternoon sun. Its noble aspect looking benignly down on a pizza cart. Certainly, nothing could be more sacred than the weekly papal audience. But here too, in the Vatican, swirls of tourists shove and push and try to follow their tour director. The Via Condotti is an elegant, if crowded, aisle of expensive swank. And the Via Sistina is home to five-star hotels, enclosed havens for weary travellers whose feet hurt and whose senses reel from the sights, the sounds, the smells of modern Rome. On all sides, impressions vie for one's attention. Yes, the sacred and the profane, side by side, cheek by jowl. But if one were to look for Rome at its most sacred, its most divine, one could not go far wrong by zeroing in on the Scala Sancta, the holy steps near the Lateran Palace. According to tradition, they were brought here from Jerusalem. It is popularly supposed that Christ climbed these steps for his interview with Pontius Pilate. Wood protects the 28 marble risers, worn smooth by the knees of pilgrims down through the ages. And to this day, the faithful ascend on their knees, rosary in hand, their faces lit from within, like this humble nun. Such then is Rome, layer upon layer of history. 2,500 years of it. Art, glory, ruin, splendor. SPQR, the Senate and people of Rome.
Popes, emperors, artists, soldiers, workmen in the streets, shoppers, lovers, churchmen, entrepreneurs. Theirs is Rome, the once and forever eternal city.